So Miss Richfield has a very distinct look. Like, you could spot Miss Richfield from across a hall or a street in P-Town. You could hear her too, probably. Yes. What went into the creation of what inspired you to make her look the way she looks?
Oh, that was a total accident. I had a black wig that I had bought at a costume store someplace. And it was just a little, you know, had little, it's just a page boy with bangs and spit curls. It was flat, you know, it was just and I thought, oh, well, that'll be smart. And I could put hats on over it or whatever, you know. And I was just doing this for fun at the first time. And then I thought, oh, glasses would be funny. She should wear glasses just because most performers don't wear glasses. And so, and it would age her a little bit, make her a little bit older. And so I took, somebody said, well, you should take that wig. Because, of course, I've got tons of gay friends. I'm working at the AIDS Project. I'm getting tons of advice, essentially, yeah. What I'm talking about. And I told people I was going to do this, you know, invited people to come and see me. Because I thought I was just going to do it one time. I thought, I'm just going to do this once. I'm just going to invite everybody. So I invited my boss. It was like 60 people that worked there, and probably 30 of them showed up. And so somebody said, well, you should take the wig to Tom Schmidt, this famous wig guy in Minneapolis, our hair guy. I mean, he owned a big salon. And he'll probably do the wig up for you. So I, you know, take this like simple wig, and when I went to pick it up, it was just gigantic. I was like, what did you do to my hair? You know, I mean, at first I didn't really, I mean, he probably thought I didn't like it, because I didn't. I was like, what is this? You know, because I just wanted a flat wig. You know, I thought just something easy that I didn't have to contend with. And so then it was this big, you know, with the bangs. And so he came up with it. It wasn't anything I did. And it just worked well. So I just stuck with it. And then the glasses I got at an antique store, they were actually vintage glasses, and they were sparkly. I ended up breaking them at one point. But so I got those. The first time I performed, I don't think I had glasses. But, you know, always a handbag and always gloves. Because I worked full time, and I didn't have time to do my nails, and I was emceeing shows. And so it was constantly, I think I wore nails like the first two times I performed. And after that, it was just impossible, because I was constantly working with clipboards and pens and microphones, and it just wasn't. And so they were falling off, and then I was gluing them on, and then my nails looked so bad because I was constantly prying glue off my, so then I was like, just wear gloves, you know? And so I wore gloves, and I didn't realize at the time that Phyllis Diller was one of the first female comedians to be in stand-up, and she always wore gloves. Mm-hmm. And part of the reason she did was because clowns wear gloves. And she said it was much more clown-like, and the men were much more willing to accept me as a clown than a woman.
Do you feel empowered when you use the glasses? It's like almost like you transform with the glasses?
Yeah, and I think it's all of it, because I've had it rarely, but once in a blue moon, I've walked out on stage without gloves, and that just totally, like, I can barely talk, you know? Or you realize you don't have your glasses on. I've done that before too, where suddenly I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't have glasses on. Mm. And then, yeah, so it doesn't, it's like the whole combination of things, you know? And so when I'm on, like, sometimes I'll do this type of a thing in drag, and I still get all dressed. Like, I don't just get dressed from the waist up. I can't.
Waist up.
Put on the tights.
Gym shorts.
Shoes. Nobody sees it, but you're right. It just transforms you into this world, you know? That said, though, when I do radio, I'll do a call-in and radio, and then I don't get dressed, and I'm able to, I'm able to kind of close my eyes and become Miss Richfield and create, you know, oh, you know, I'm standing on the corner of 66 and Lindale on the payphone, you know, you know, and I can kind of create that in my mind, but it's hard when you're not dressed.
Right, but do you get tired sometimes of her? Like, because one of the things, and I think Sean, you know, studying to become an actor, and it's certain days that you feel like, I don't want to do this, has a Ross, right?
Yeah.
How you are able to say, no, well, but she need to come to stage, she need to perform in days that you don't feel like it.
Well, it's interesting because the character is multidimensional, and that helps. because the character has a backstory, and she's, you know, and in my mind, as well as I think a lot of other people's minds, she exists. You know, she's right now, she's, you know, probably at home, you know, who knows, doing what, or, you know, visiting with the neighbors, or picking up beer bottles out of her yard because her neighbor just had a party or something, you know, but she's doing something right now. So in my mind, she sort of exists, which is helpful. And for me, it's a helpful way out of myself. And so there's times where, like the other night, you know, before bingo, it was just chaos and, you know, everything was going wrong. And, you know, the thing starts, it starts on the top of the hour, whether you're ready or not, you know, right. The thing goes. So you better be ready because, you know, the song plays and you're on, you know, this, and I'm in my kitchen with, you know, nobody else. So it's not like it's really any help. And so things were, you know, it's just a mess, and somebody had made a poor decision and I didn't know about it until like a half an hour before. And it was just, you know, so then I'm frantically trying to correct that. And then the thing goes on and I was fine. Right. Like, hello, because you become her. And then suddenly it's like, my problems don't matter anymore. And it was just really amazing that in beforehand, we have other people. It takes five of us to run that freaking bingo. And so other people are on and we're talking to each other. And that's what one of them said after. He goes, God, he goes, I wasn't sure what we were going to have when the camera went up. I was really mad. You know, I was just like, all right, let's just turn the thing on. Let's go. You know, hi. So the guy was like, I didn't know what to expect when we went on the air. Yeah. But it was fine because, like, she's happy all the time. So as tired as I might get of her, which I don't really get too tired of her, because she's so upbeat and so happy, and the world is good, you know, according to her, and everything's going to work out, and, you know, she doesn't quite understand what's going on exactly, but she thinks she has all the answers, and, you know, and so there's an element of her, the naivety, that is really nice to have in these complicated times where she's just a glass is half full, everything's fine, kind of a gal.
Yeah,
and I mean, so
she is. We
how
watch
do you not enjoy that? And I look at people who, you know, are insult comics that, you know, really go after people, and I think that would, and she insults people, but, you know, naively, you know, I mean, she's the one that looks stupid. You know, she may insult you, but she's the one that looks like an idiot. Right. And so it's just, you know, how can you not enjoy that?
John, your turn to try to wrap it up.
Come on. That's so much pressure.
I'm telling you, I mean, if it were me, I can be here the whole day, but it's
yeah, right.
Go.
We could chat the whole day for sure.
Okay. So as a performer, as an artist, as, someone that exists in the queer community, and we talked a little bit about it, but for you, what does queer representation and being a part of that movement mean?
Wow, it's a great question. And it's a great question for today, because I think our community is changing so much with the political climate. And in a sense, unfortunately, it's a political, we're tied to a political movement. I think it's a human rights movement. I don't think it's a political movement, but in our country, human rights are political. It's unfortunate. It's always been that way. It's that way in a lot of countries, unfortunately. So I think for me, I am so happy that I came out when I did. It was during the AIDS epidemic. It was really during the dying years of the AIDS epidemic that I came out. It started in AIDS work, volunteering and all that. And we just had a real coming together at that point in the mid to late 80s, all the way through the mid to late 90s. It was a real coming together of the community. And it was a real coming of age of us to stand up and say we want to be counted. There wasn't protection in the workplace, and in some cases there still isn't. There was certainly no gay marriage. There was a lot of discrimination. And so for those of us that grew up in that, it's difficult now to see people who don't want to be gay, you know, or don't want to be part of our community. They feel like, oh, yeah, I don't really want to be labeled. And it's sort of hard to hear that, because there's people who've given their lives. I mean, read about Stonewall. That wasn't that long ago. You know, I was 7 years old when that happened. And people were losing their jobs. They were losing their kids. You know, they were losing, you know, they would get caught in a sting. Their name would be in the paper. Their picture would be in the paper. They wouldn't have a job. Their wife would divorce them. They never see their kids again. And it was a tough time. And that was not that long ago. And all that can happen again. I don't think it will happen that way again, but I think it can come back and we can have that climate again. It's sort of how I feel about Roe v. Wade and the conservative Republican Supreme Court that we now have, where we have five Catholic white men on the Supreme Court, which is what they say. I mean, not to get political or anything, but but you asked.
So,
yeah, queerness is inherently political. So.
Right.
If in our country, it is, I think.
Thank you so much for being here. We
Thank
are
you.
Big, big fan. Please keep your good work. Keep us feeling good and happy. And thank you so much for making our life so special.
And keep coming to Bingo Bonanza.
Yes, we will be sure everybody's there every Mondays and Thursdays.
Yes, Monday and Thursday, 8 Eastern, 7 Central, 5 Pacific.
Through Facebook page, correct?
Yeah, or playbingobonanza.com. You can play it on that too. It's a little easier than Facebook.
Perfect. We will be there. Thank you so much for being here. We appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Bye.